Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the seventh meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind members, witnesses and staff that social distancing rules are still in place, and please respect those. And if you are moving around the room or entering or exiting the room, if you could wear a face covering. But while you're sat at the table, you can remove your face covering. The first item for the committee is to consider whether to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Yes, it is agreed. Thank you. Agenda item 2 is to consider the social care briefing, which was brought out at the end of January by the Auditor General along with the Accounts Commission. And I'm delighted to welcome with us this morning, first of all, remotely, committee member Willie Coffey is joining us. But in the committee room is the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle. Welcome, Auditor General. And your team this morning who are joining us remotely are Anthony Clark, who's the Interim Director of Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland, and Sheila Stewart, who's Audit Manager, Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland. You're both welcome. And can I say to Anthony and Sheila and to Willie, if at any point you want to come in, please just put R in the chat box function, and we will endeavour to take you in. And I'm quite sure in Anthony and Sheila's case, the Auditor General may well defer to you to pick up some of the evidence that we will be looking for. But can I begin, Auditor General, by inviting you to make an opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I am bringing to the committee this morning our briefing on social care. It draws on findings from our earlier reporting on health and social care integration, people's experiences of social care services, together with public sector reform. We have previously reported on the challenges within social care, including aspects on the fragility of the workforce, tensions between cost and quality in commissioning services, lack of progress in shifting resources to preventative approaches, and gaps in key data needed to inform decision making. Unfortunately, these challenges, along with others, continue to threaten the sustainability of social care services and are having a huge impact on the people who rely upon them. My joint briefing with the Accounts Commission sets out the key challenges, some recent progress, what needs to happen urgently and not wait for reform. People should be at the heart of social care services, but we know that service users and carers do not always have a say or choice about what support works best for them. People have described the struggle they go through trying to receive appropriate services, but have also described the huge impact on their ability to live independently when it works well and when they get the support that they need. It is paramount that the Scottish Government embeds the voice of people with personal experience in all aspects of developing, planning and delivering improvements to social care. This is essential to deliver the aspiration of a preventative, human rights-based approach. We know that the social care workforce has been under immense pressure, both before and during the pandemic. The predominantly female workforce does not feel adequately rewarded or valued. There are also major problems with recruitment and retention. Both the Fair Work Convention and Fair Work and Social Care Group have made recommendations. The Scottish Government now needs to take action to improve working conditions for this vitally important workforce. Otherwise, it won't be able to deliver its ambitions for social care. Our briefing also notes the challenges with social care commissioning system. It tends to focus on costs rather than quality or outcomes, and this creates wider structural problems. The current method of competitive tendering, based on framework agreements with unspecified hours, can pass risk onto staff and results in 0 hours or sessional contracts. Our briefing refers to surveys that highlight staff do not always feel that they have the necessary time to deliver person-centred care. This is another key area the Scottish Government needs to focus on as it takes forward its plans with local government partners and those in the private and third sectors. Pressures from increasing demand and demographic changes are growing. This has led to tighter eligibility criteria being applied for accessing care and increasing levels of unmet need. There are also major gaps in the data and the true picture of demand and unmet need is unclear. This needs to improve to inform decision-making. Convener, to conclude, some things cannot wait for the establishment of a national care service. Stakeholders have told us about services in near crisis, and a lack of ambition now presents serious risks to the delivery of care services for individuals. The Scottish Government needs to take a pragmatic approach and set out what can be improved now without legislation, while also taking time to determine where the National Care Service can add most value. Convener, as ever, Anthony, Sheila and myself will do our utmost to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, and we will have questions covering the whole range of issues raised in the briefing, which I think is extensive and raises some matters of concern. I mean, not least about the fact that I think £5.2 billion of public expenditure is currently invested in social care, and yet there are some things highlighted in the report which I think, you know, draw us towards them, which are of some concern. I mean, you say that there is increasing demand and demographic changes and still a lot of unmet need. So I suppose the issue for us that we want to begin with looking at is that whole question of the sustainability of the social care system. I mean, you've made it clear from the report that whilst the Parliament in this session is legislating for the creation of a national care service, there is a degree of urgency around the action that's needed to tackle some of those unmet needs and some of those challenges which social care and social care providers and the social care workforce face. In fact, at one point you describe in the briefing that it is at near crisis. Do you think the Scottish Government is putting sufficient resources into social care?
So I think it's a variety of components, Convener, actually. That one of the aspects, perhaps two things to touch on, and I'll maybe ask Sheila to elaborate on both of these, is the pay and reward that the workforce and the conditions that they operate in. So the nature of this service is very person dependent, both the experience that people who are in receipt of care receive and also those who are delivering care services. As ever, you mentioned that, you know, resources are significant, but that the resources that we're currently putting into the social care services have still led us to a point that users of the service and those that work in it are telling us about the difficult experiences that they have. So pay and reward is a very clear component, as well as the working conditions of the workforce. The representative groups in the sector have talked about it, that in terms of pay and reward, it's not just about those who are working, delivering frontline services, is the whole structure of pay and reward across the all aspects of the social care system. That's one point I would make, Convener. And the second is, as we touched on in introductory remarks, is the nature of the competitive tendering structure that we have that focuses more on cost as opposed to quality and the experience of people who are using the social care services. Both of those factors may result in additional resource being put into the sector. We would recognise, I think, as we touch on in the briefing, that there are plans to significantly increase further the resources into the sector, government's own plans, and then what may come from the additional national insurance contributions as those come to the Scottish Government. Both of those are significant in terms of additional resource into the system. But in terms of where we are currently, Convener, urgent action is needed to resolve some of these challenges. If I may, I'll pause and perhaps turn to Sheila, if anything she wishes to add.
I think that really covers a lot, you know, the main points we've raised. I'll maybe just pull out some of the detail around the sort of systemic problems. As the Auditor General said in the introduction to the briefing and the Fair Work Convention concluded, there is something about the commissioning system and how it then leads to risk, the unspecified contractual arrangement. That risk does get moved down to staff being asked to work very flexibly with zero-hour contracts or low-hours contracts. So, you know, that's a really a big and really difficult thing to grapple with. But again, something that we feel action needs to be taken on now rather than necessarily waiting for the establishment of a national.
Right, thank you. And so you mentioned points around commissioning and workforce and reward and so on, and we've got a series of questions that we're going to come to on that. But if I could just turn to one of the other striking things about the briefing, and that is where you're saying how important it is that service users' perspective and voice is seen and heard. And a suggestion that perhaps it isn't being seen and heard as much as it might be at the moment. So I guess the question is, what work is the Scottish Government carrying out that you're aware of that seeks to bring in the views of service users, their families and those receiving care? You know, what work is being done by the Scottish Government to seek those views so that in turn that's used to inform its strategic planning of social care in Scotland?
Yeah, again, I'll happily start, Convener, and Sheila will want to elaborate about kind of the steps that the government's taking. If I may, I think there's a couple of points that we know that government have involved users and sought the views of representative groups, both in the consultation around the independent review of adult social care and then their consultation on the plans for a national care service, and that's clear. It matters incredibly so, and I think if I draw the committee's attention in the briefing paper, that we sought to reflect some of the views of those working in and those in receipt of the service about their current perspective of how that operates, some of the challenges that they and their families are finding with the service, and then particularly aspects of what they would refer to as some of the bureaucracy that exists around the system of where they are, both struggles to receive the adequate care packages make progress with self-directed support, and then along with challenges of moving between one provider to another or moving area, and how challenging all of that has felt for people. In terms of the government's plans and the importance of that, again, I'll pass to Sheila just to update the committee on where the government is planning to go next.
Yes, we do absolutely make the point that people in receiving an experience with social care support need to be part of the solution and be involved. So, you know, we know from the consultation on the NCS that that's been built in. There's been a lot of forums and individual consultation events happening, as well as the opportunity given for people to put in their written submissions. We know about the social covenant group as well that's been established, so that's really heartening to see that more formal mechanism be introduced. There's also fantastic organisations out there that represent people in the seat of social care. There's the Alliance, who just yesterday morning held a conference around the National Care Service. There's the Equality and Human Rights Commission as well. And Enable Scotland. There's lots of partners that the Scottish Government can work with. And I think, again, in terms of next step and looking forwards, in the briefing, we do recommend that the Scottish Government works in partnership with other stakeholders who have a lot of knowledge and intelligence to bring on this.
Right. Thanks, Sheila. I think Anthony Clark wants to come in on this point as well. So, Anthony.
Good morning, committee. I just wanted to add a little bit to a couple of the points that the Auditor General and Stephen have already made. I mean, they've already made the point that the Scottish Government is working very hard with service user groups around the consultation and responding to the consultation on the independent review of adult care, the Feely review, as you know. But it's worth maybe just drawing out a couple of points that Feely set out in his report, which was about the importance of service users having a voice in the commissioning process, which I think is very important. Making sure that users have a much more active role working with providers and commissioners to make sure that when services are designed for their local area, they actually reflect the needs of people that will be using those services. And one of the constraints, I think, hitherto in this area around choice has been a lack of capacity in the system. So this is partly a byproduct of the pressure that social care providers and local authorities have faced over difficult for them to range of choices served in the Feely review. So I just wanted to make the point around commissioning in the future. And my final point, if I may, is a more general point about quality. In his introduction, the Auditor General made the point that commissioning tends to focus on cost rather than quality. In the Feely review report, there were some very important points being made that might require changes to happen around regulation and inspection of social care services, so that the measures of success bring much more to the centre, the lived experience of people as well. So that could be a very important development moving forward as the Scottish Government and others start to develop the National Care Service. I thought they'll touch on the points that you're asking about, convener, so hopefully that was useful.
Yeah, that's very useful. And I think, as I say, we've got further questions about commissioning, and there's a whole debate about whether the commissioning model is actually the best model in and of itself, and is the current model quite top-down, is the way it certainly seems to me, and I'm not quite sure the voice of users is heard sufficiently loudly. But that's, I think, is going to be part of the debate we're going to have in the Parliament about the creation of the National Care Service, as well as addressing some of the more urgent points that you've asked us to push on. One of the other pieces of legislation which is mentioned in the report is the 2013 Act, which provided for self-directed support. And, you know, I think we reflect that your predecessor, Stephen, produced a report, I think, in 2017, along again with the Accounts Commission, concluding that the vision of self-directed support had not been fully delivered and implemented at that point. So the question that we wanted to put to you today was, how much further on are we? You know, how would you describe today the status of the implementation of self-directed support?
Thank you, Convener. You're quite right. And this briefing paper draws on our previous body of work, including the self-directed support paper. I think Anthony, I'm sure, will want to say a word about perhaps just some of the background to that report and progress. We capture to an extent in this briefing paper, albeit not an audit of self-directed support, the ongoing frustration that the sector is experiencing with the progress around self-directed support, that it is still too hard for people to make progress with their packages to support independent living, to recruit personal assistants, concerns about the sustainability of personal assistants, and then really the extent to which it is known and understood of what people can access by way of self-directed support. So a real degree of frustration coming through, convener, from the representative bodies, individuals who are have engaged in the service, that it hasn't progressed as initially intended. So we have signalled in this paper that it's our intention to return with a further programme of work, and look to capture really the progress around self-directed support as well. But I think in overall terms, convener, I think the findings that my predecessor and the Accounts Commission highlighted 5 years ago haven't progressed, as neither the government nor their partners would have anticipated in the intervening period. Again, I'll pause. I'm sure Anthony will want to say a few words on this as well.
Thank you very much, Stephen. And yes, I was actually involved in that 2017 report that was a follow-up to our 2014 report, so I'm relatively familiar with the audit approach and the findings as well. And I think the Auditor General's absolutely right. We set out in the briefing paper really confirms that the findings in 2017 have not moved on at the pace and scale that we would have hoped, really. The feedback from service users, which has been captured in the briefing and which was presented to the Independent Review of Adult Social Care, makes the point that the Auditor General just made, which is people are still finding it too difficult to get access to the services that they really want and have the choice and control over their own lives. I think it's fair to say that the ambition of the legislation is still not being met, and that is definitely something we want to follow up on as part of our ongoing programme of social care work.
Thank you. Thanks, Anthony. That's helpful. I just wanted to go to another piece of legislation which the Parliament has passed, which you also reflect on, which is the 2016 Carers Scotland Act, which provides for rights for unpaid carers. And I think in the report you reflect on a survey, or admittedly a 2019 survey, that was carried out by the Coalition of Carers. And bear in mind, there are 700,000 unpaid carers in Scotland, so this is a huge part of the population. That of those 700,000 in this survey, of presumably a sample of them, The survey found that only 16% of carers knew of the Act and what rights it provided. 33% had heard of it but did not know what it was about, and 51% had never heard of the Act and the rights it bestowed. So there is an issue there, isn't there, which clearly needs to be addressed. I mean, again, Auditor General, could you tell us what, as far as you are aware, the government is doing to address the fact that here we have an Act of Parliament which gives unpaid carers rights, yet many of them are ignorant of the rights that they've got?
Some of the statistics in that paragraph, paragraph 9, convener, are quite stark, actually, about the rights of 700,000 or so estimated unpaid carers in Scotland. Their familiarity with the Act and their associated rights suggests, for all that we set out in the paper, that there are real gaps in the support that's being offered to unpaid carers, and as well as their understanding about how to access support. All of this points to, I think, you know, aspects that we touched on in the report as well, about some of the gender inequality concerns of the predominantly female workforce, but female unpaid carers as well, that are not being adequately supported or given or helpfully directed to where they can access support, breaks in caring responsibilities and so forth. So we draw the conclusion, as we touched on this morning, about the near crisis and real challenge. And all of this is kind of a key plank of that judgment. It's not just the government, Scottish Government, I would say. There's also a very clear responsibility of local authorities for, you know, how they understand the role of unpaid carers in their communities. And I think also that's where the solutions lie as well, that, you know, taking some of the time to progress towards the National Care Service rightly, but also some of the interventions that can be made now. And I think it goes back to some of the questions that you started with this morning about, yes, there's additional funding going in, but can steps be taken now to address some of the commissioning models, some of the rates of care, and some of the additional support that can be provided to unpaid carers? Again, I'm happy to pause, actually, and maybe just turn. I think Sheila probably best to come in on this point.
Sheila, do you want to add anything?
Yes. But just really to echo what the Auditor General has said, it's really stark, those statistics within our briefing, and we really aren't in a position to be able to give an update on the Scottish Government's current intention to address that. But, you know, as the Auditor General said, there's other partners that are part of the solution for this too. That's all I've got to go.
Yeah, that's fine, Sheila. Thank you very much. Well, already we've mentioned a few times the social care workforce, and Willie Coffey, who's joining us virtually, has got some questions to put to you about the workforce. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everyone in the panel. Firstly, before I come to the workforce issues, convener, I wonder if I could just ask the Auditor General to say something about how his briefing complements, reflects, mirrors, or otherwise the Feely report that was commissioned and released about a year ago. How much does it find itself in harmony with what was being recommended in there, Steve, and what progress has been made, you say?
Morning, Mr. Coffey. I think it's a very very clear read across between the findings of the Feely report and our own briefing that the committee has this morning. I think that sense of, you know, reform being needed, concerns about the sustainability of the sector, the need to incorporate the human rights-based approach for people who are receiving care packages, and then the need for a real change in thinking about, for people who work in the sector, that we are adequately addressing concerns about the sustainability of addressing recruitment and retention issues, offering fair work so that we move the sector on from some of the sustainability issues that are set out in both Feely's report and our own briefing. And you know, whilst Feely didn't cover all the aspects that are set out in the National Care Service plans of the Scottish Government, that it sufficiently tackles some of the urgent concerns at present. But in the round, we'd agree, Mr. Coffey, that there are parallels and read across between Feely's report and our own briefing.
Okay, thank you. So, turning to some of the issues in your briefing around the workforce, it tells us about the difficult environment paid social care workforce is operating within, and including, you know, it talks about an increasing demand for social care, coupled with a wide range of recruitment and retention challenges. What do you think the government is doing or has been doing to respond to that challenge and to make sure that we increase the numbers of people that we're getting with social care skills?
You're right, there are a couple of points to address. So the briefing paper, we set out that there are around 210,000 people who are paid employees in the social care sector. And the report recognised that the government has taken steps to bring in the living wage for people who work in the sector. And in paragraph 11, I think is the apology, I'll give the correct paragraph reference if I get it. Paragraph 26 to the report, we set out some of the government's plans for additional investment. So 25% cash terms increase in the sector over the life of this parliamentary term, around £800 million of additional funding. So there are clear plans for investment, Mr. Coffey, no doubt, but in terms of over the life of the parliamentary term and the living wage, it hasn't addressed the very specific challenges that the sector is currently facing in terms of very high vacancy rates in the sector and the overall attractability of people wanting to come into a very responsible, demanding role. Concerns about career progression, stress, anxiety, the burden that has been placed upon people who worked in the sector, particularly during the course of the pandemic, and that there are other options for people to deploy their career choices. The sector or the government hasn't offered support, but in terms of reforming and rethinking the sector, these are the challenges to be addressed.
Auditor General, I think Anthony wants to come in on this point as well. So, Willie, before you ask your next question, I'll invite Anthony to give some views.
Thanks very much. Willie, I just want to say a couple of other things as well. If you look at paragraph 14 of the briefing paper, we set out the developments that have taken place around the living wage, which is obviously a positive development that's happening recently to try and make working in social care more attractive. And committee members might remember that there was a relatively big advertising campaign fairly recently to try and attract people into the social care workforce. But it does feel as though there's a bigger challenge there, which is about public perceptions of social care. And it feels as though we value nursing and medical support, and yet we don't really seem to value social care support in quite the same way. And I think that's been well recognised by people and people in the sector as well. So I think the Feely recommendations are partly about trying to make that shift. And there's also a big issue in the Feely report, as you'll know, Mr. Coffey, which is around career pathways and development, so that people care at a modest level, you know, entry level, but then think that this might be a job for life. So there's quite a job of work to do, I think, nationally and locally around career progression and development opportunities, which are recognised in the proposal for the National Care Service.
Thanks for that, Anthony. It kind of leads us, convener, into my next question, really. When we considered the report on Scotland's colleges, the principal at Edinburgh College tried some of the more innovative approaches that college was taking to address this increasing demand for social care, for a social care workforce. It included enabling students studying social care disciplines to undertake a mixture of studies, skills development and work-based opportunities, and even a dual qualification in child care and social care. Is that kind of thinking being reflected across Scotland, and is it having any positive impact?
I'm not sure we have a definitive answer to that, Mr. Coffey. I remember the session well and the contributions from the principal and the evidence and the conviction with which they spoke about the impact that was having And you know, having listened carefully to just to see the progress that that make to tackle some of the problems about the sustainability of the workforce, as Anthony mentions, to have that move the profession onto a different setting to give it absolute due parity with the National Health Service and some of the steps that are able to be taken. I think it may be something that we'd need to come back to the committee in writing if we have any more detail on it, or perhaps something that the committee wishes to explore directly with some of the college sector.
Okay. Your brief, Stephen, also talks about the commitment made by the government to pay adult social care staff real living wage. So we're talking about wages and money now, but it might still not be enough to attract people into the sector. What would you say to that? And issues about career progression. It's not just coming in at the entry level and that's you forever more. Do we need to be thinking about career progression and opportunities to improve not only pay but their prospects too?
Yeah, very much. I mean, I think that's one of the key findings from the briefing, and also kind of listening to some of the contributions from representative groups and watching some of the evidence that was given to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee last week. That comes through really clearly, actually, that the living wage in itself is welcome and a step forward. But in order to support the sustainability of this workforce, it is about making it an attractive, long-term place that people will want to stay, work and develop their careers. And one of the things that kind of hear clearly in some of those voices is that it matters not just at the entry-level points of people joining the social care sector, but throughout the various grades that there's adequate training, support, supervision, managers in the sector to oversee training, development needs and all of those factors. But I think it's a question of parity as well, Mr. Coffey, that too often the concerns of the sector is seen as somehow not as important, doesn't enjoy the profile that the NHS enjoys, and to shift on some of that thinking that this is seen as a valued profession for people to work in, and hard work that it is too, and to reap the right level of respect and fair work that goes alongside that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and turning to retention issues, Stephen, your report gives us a worrying that 1 in 4, 25% of staff actually leave within the first 3 months. And that must be quite a worry. Could you maybe give us some more information on why is that? Is it pandemic related or was it happening before the pandemic? And what can we possibly do to turn that around?
Yeah, you're right, Mr. Coffey. I'll turn to Sheila again in a moment or two, but I think at paragraph 15, we set out some of the statistics of the challenges in the sector. As you say, a quarter of staff leave within 3 months. Nearly 90% of social care providers say that recruitment and retention is problematic, and that some of the representative bodies have had to reduce the volume of care and as a consequence of some of the recruitment and retention issues that they've experienced. I think for the reasons that we set out in the briefing paper, that these factors existed before the pandemic, but that were exacerbated by it. It's hard work, as we know, convener, that these are difficult, demanding, responsible jobs. And as I'm sure we'll come on to over the course of the discussion this morning, one of the other factors is about the transfer of risk to people who work in the sector. Aspects of 0 hours contracts, sessional contracts, not necessarily being given the right time that people would want to spend in providing care, concerns about travelling between different locations, and who owns that risk. And too often, and we're seeing in the evidence in our gathering, is that transfer of risk is onto the people who are working in the sector. So all of these factors are undoubtedly components of where we've arrived at in terms of recruitment and retention. Mr. Coffey, again, I'll pause. I'm sure Sheila will want to add.
Because that was a really comprehensive answer there. So I think it's very difficult for us to be able to say if it was the additional pressures of working through the pandemic that's led, you know, that's impacted on these statistics, that people do seem to leave the profession or at least a place of work within 3 months. And so just again to mirror that they need to make it an attractive career that and that people are feeling valued, you know, from a monetary perspective, but also just that they're able to spend time building relationships and investing in the care of the people that they are working with.
Yeah, thanks for that, Sheila. Stephen, I wonder if I could just turn now to commissioning issues, commissioning services and issues. And your brief also tells us that we tend to focus on costs rather than on quality or outcomes, and that's despite spending £5 billion in the overall service. But do you think there's a case that for those that were involved in commissioning services to get them in early, at an early stage, so that, that kind of tension between cost and outcome could, to some degree, be avoided?
I think Anthony will want to come in on this, I'm sure, as well, Mr. Coffey. But I think that's a fair conclusion about moving towards a more collaborative approach for commissioning of social care services, as opposed to what we are being told is feels like a very competitive environment and all the instability that that can lead to providers, particularly small providers, and the doubt about the sustainability of their business model if they are unable to secure contracts. We touched already in previous answers about, you know, the transfer of risk to people who are working in the sector and the unsustainable sense of employment that exists as a consequence of that. And therefore, yes, you know, so Anthony, I'm sure, wanted to say more, but a collaborative approach to commissioning feels like a more sustainable model than we currently have in Scotland. But again, Anthony can say a bit more. Mr. Coffey.
Just to completely agree with the Auditor General, Mr. Coffey. In fact, we made in 2016 in the Social Work in Scotland report that there should be earlier engagement between providers and commissioners as part of the development of commissioning strategies and commissioning processes. And you do see some good examples of that, where local authorities and IJBs are working constructively and productively with local providers, both private and third sector providers, in understanding the needs of the local area and developing innovative solutions and services. But I think it's probably the exception rather than the rule. And that's certainly the feedback that we've heard from people that are representatives of provider bodies like the SSC and also the Alliance. What the proposal that you put forward there, Mr. Coffey, and it's something that we've said earlier in a previous report.
Thank you. And Auditor General, your report also reminds us that there was £500 million extra awarded to government in 1920. But the big question, of course, is do you know how much of that funding was used for social care commissioning purposes, or did it find its way elsewhere?
I'm not sure. I know. I think Anthony's probably best placed to answer that question in terms of his more familiarity with the work of local government, Anthony.
I can't give you a clear answer at the moment, Mr. Coffey. We're quite interested in that question, though. We're currently working our way through all of the annual audits of integration joint boards, which might give us some insights, but I'm afraid not able at the moment to give you a clear answer to that question.
Okay. Right. My final question, Convener, it was just really about the competition issue that the Auditor General raised there, but I think you've adequately covered that, Stephen, that if we have more of a collaborative approach and people are involved at an earlier stage, we might gain more rather than focusing on cost, we might actually focus on quality. So I think I'll just hand back to yourself, Convener, and allow the other members to come in now. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. That's much appreciated. I'm going to turn now to Colin Beattie, who's got a series of questions on leadership and culture and some of the other big issues raised in the report. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, it's not the first time we've seen adverse comments about leadership in your reports, and you do mention this in paragraph 20 of your report. I mean, you call for stable and collaborative leadership, and that sounds a fairly basic thing that you would expect to be in place. You particularly mention that councils and integration authorities are experiencing high turnover of senior staff, and you previously said that it's the same situation in the NHS. Why is there such a high turnover of senior staff across the public sector. In my memory, until a few years ago, that was, generally speaking, not the case. So what has triggered this?
I think I'd need to check, Mr. Beattie, in terms of the trend of turnover, I think. But you're right, we are experiencing that not just in one sector, but as you mentioned, in the NHS and local government too. The predecessor committee took evidence on in respect of the NHS and the turnover of leadership and the various factors behind that, about the demands of their role, the attractiveness of it, some of the accountability arrangements, no doubt too. But we are in a challenging set of circumstances. I'll say a bit more about the NHS, and I think turn to Anthony, who want to comment about local government and IJBs. But some of the nature of turnover is not just confined to chief executives, but also about some of the other key leadership roles in that. And I think it comes back to the attractiveness of the role and the alternatives that are on offer to senior officials. The stability of leadership is key to moving away and addressing some of the challenges that we set out in the report, tackling the sustainability of the sector and the collaboration between local authorities, NHS and third sector providers. All of that has to happen to move this sector onto a more sustainable footing.
Is it about money? Is it simply their job hopping for more money?
I think that's a factor, but not as simple as that. You know, we do see people who will move from one sector to the next, who will have, you know, career progression aspirations met from moving from an integrated joint board into a council or NHS board. You know, these things happen, and that's perfectly legitimate for individuals. Where the concern raises is the volume of change, learning new roles at a time of real challenge, and the need for, I think, all the points of stable leadership produces better outcomes. All these factors are noted, but I think we're talking about more structural issues. I think leadership is one component of it, but that the overriding concerns, I would suggest, are more about the attractiveness of the roles at different levels across the organisation and some of the commissioning context. But this absolutely needs tackled. I think, if you're content, I was going to...
Can I just add one thing, which maybe if Anthony's coming in after, sure, or whoever. I can understand where there's an issue about stability. If there is a turnover of senior staff, a churn there, it does create that... almost a vacuum until that the person moving in has come up to speed with the job and got a grip of it and so on. What I don't understand is lack of collaboration, because collaboration should be fundamental and it should be embedded there, regardless of stability or whatever. That collaboration should exist. Why doesn't it exist?
It's a really important question. We refer to cultural differences in the report, Mr. to that, and it's not for the first time. You know, I think even referencing the reporting that we have done on health and social care integration, that cultural differences between local government, the NHS and the Scottish Government have all been noted and played a part in the experience that people ultimately get, whether it's a lack of collaboration between leaders, differences of views on budgets, different systems, how they are integrating. All are noted and haven't moved on for the best part of 10 years that we've sought to move towards a more preventative agenda for health and social care, providing care closer to people's homes. All of these factors haven't been addressed sufficiently to lead to better experience of people that are using and relying on the provision of health and social care. We've said over many years, and probably frustratingly so, that some of these cultural differences need to be addressed to move to that more collaborative approach. But yet we're still here reporting concerns that culture is still getting in the way of better outcomes for people.
Who needs to knock the heads together to make this happen?
We've all got responsibility, I think, which is clear. So, you know, government, local government, NHS, their partners, to... take steps and move on from some of these issues that are known. And I think it's not a universal picture. I think that probably some of the additional frustration, Mr. Beattie, that there are many examples across the country of where cultural differences have been overcome. You know, some real examples of progress, particularly over the course of the pandemic, where issues that had felt intractable for many years were set aside and progress towards better outcomes have been delivered. And perhaps that's the opportunity now that we all need to reflect on, that you know, when it had to happen, progress was made, and to build on some of those innovations. But I see Anthony kind of is keen to come in on this point. I think it would be useful to hear from him in terms of the role that local government is playing in, and also some of the innovations that we've seen, if he wants to comment on that too.
Thank you very much, Auditor General. If I might just quickly turn to Mr. Beattie's question around turnover in local government. There's always been turnover in local government at the senior level, as we'd expect, both at chief executive and you know, executive director level as well. But I think it's noticeable that over the last year or so, we have seen in many ways a changing of the guard. So many of the chief executives that came into senior around the time of local government reorganisation in 96, I think it was, we've seen a whole tranche of those people leaving. So that's created quite a big shift, a generational shift in local government leadership. That's not necessarily a bad thing, it's a thing. It does mean that new people are coming in with fresh ideas, but it does mean there's been a big change of thinking in the local government sector. There's always been shifts in IJBs as well. And I think that's often been about career progression, people moving from a smaller IJB to a larger IJB to move forward in their career. But more recently, we have seen some IJB chief officers moving into local authority chief executive roles as well. And I'm thinking of the chief executive of Inverclyde. I think in some ways that's quite a welcome development, people being able to demonstrate they can move across different bits of the public sector. And that does, I think, in many ways support the collaborative leadership that I think you were wanting to see, Mr. Beattie. The collaborative leadership question, which we've talked about many times in many of our audit reports, still feels vexed and problematic. I think the Auditor General's right. We've seen great joint working during the period of the pandemic because people have had a singular and shared goal, and everyone was clear what it is they needed to focus on, which was dealing with the immediate pressing impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic on jobs, health and communities. I think the danger is that as we move from recovery to response and renewal, people might then retreat back into their kind of more professional health, police and fire, local government. So I think there is a risk around that we need to be all alert to. But I'm optimistic that what we've seen in the pandemic hopefully will be sustained moving forward. But hopefully that's helpful, Mr. Beattie.
I mean, I'm very conscious, as the Auditor General's mentioned, of the fact that this question of collaboration at local level has been raised, certainly in my 11 years in this committee, several times in your reports. And yet nothing seems to progress. You say in some places are better than others, but all places should have that level of collaboration that allows the outcomes that the government and everybody else is hoping to be achieved. What has to happen? I mean, it can't go on that you churn out a report saying, you know, there's a lack of collaboration locally, which is impairing progress. It can't go on like that. But it has. How do we break that?
We, in Audit Scotland, both myself and the Accounts Commission, reflected on the 10-year anniversary of the Christie Report towards the end of last year that touches on many of these aspects of why we haven't progressed with the level of collaboration leading to better outcomes in Scotland. And we identified, I suppose, in the round, an implementation gap between policy ambitions and what happens next. The committee has also heard about in previous sessions about some of the performance measures, the incentives that we are providing to support better outcomes, and those not always being sufficiently clear for people working and leading in the sectors to deliver it. So I think that's one aspect of it. I think we also reflected on our own role about, you know, the audit and scrutiny role that's also directed towards improved outcomes. There is no single answer, Mr. Beattie, because I think as we touch on towards the end of the report and reflecting on what might come next through a national care service and learning some of the lessons from previous significant aspects of public sector reform in Scotland that haven't produced the intended outcomes at the pace that was originally anticipated, police and fire reform, some of the colleges reforms as well. And we make a number of recommendations for As Scotland, as we anticipate, and as the convener mentions, that the pending scrutiny of the National Care Service, about some of the points that policymakers will want to reflect on as we move towards that, that there are clear milestones, clear intended outcomes, and that we're able to measure that. But I don't think that sets aside the need for effective collaboration and to make some of the changes now. One thing I haven't mentioned the committee may want to explore this morning is about the data. And, you know, the quality of data and metrics across different organisations also needs to move on. And as I'm sure you know, the committee will feel, again, a frustratingly recurring theme that, through audit reporting, that data isn't sufficient, it's not readable, it's not transferable in the way that it needs to be to deliver better outcomes for people.
I'll come back to data in just a second. I'm going to ask you an unfair question, which you may or may not be able to answer. Looking at social care in the public sector versus the private sector, how significant a difference is there in quality of leadership, or isn't there?
I'm grateful for you kind of recognising that I may not be able to answer that, Mr. Beattie, and I think that's probably where I'm at, is that, again, I'm not sure we have done enough audit work to, or even have the necessary scope or remit to make that kind of definitive judgment. I think, as Anthony has mentioned and we touched on in the report, we're looking to recognise that stable, collaborative leadership is a key component of better outcomes for people, whether it's in the private sector or the public sector. There are no doubt differences of experience that users of social care will have, depending on whether they are receiving care from a local authority provider or a third sector or private sector provider. But as you suggest, I'm not sure we have done enough audit work to have a clear position on that.
Auditor General Anthony has indicated he wants to come in. Perhaps he's going to answer this question which Colin Beattie has put. Anthony, do you want to come in?
I'm sorry to disappoint you, Convener. I'm not going to answer your question, but I'm going to point you to someone who I think can answer the question, which is the Care Inspectorate. So the Care Inspectorate inspects and regulates all of the services that Mr. Beattie has an interest in, terms of quality that they talk about his leadership. I do reflect that I think they have done some analysis comparing private, third sector and local authority provision. I'm hesitant to offer my what might be a hazy recollection of what that said. I think my recollection was that it didn't demonstrate a clear pattern in terms of quality of leadership across sectors, that there was variability, but it is wanted to the Care Inspectorate.
Thank you for that. I'm sure we'll be pursuing issues around collaboration and so on as we go forward. You very correctly raised the questions of data, and this is not a new issue in front of this committee. I can't remember ever you sitting there saying that the data collection in any particular area was exemplary or particularly good. But here, you're talking about, in paragraph 23, no individual social care record is taken in the same way. Each member of society has a different NHS record. There's obviously some comparison difficulties there. No consistent method for recording unmet need. No coordinated approach to anticipating future demand for and costs of delivering services, which is pretty fundamental. So are we saying that each individual area is collecting data in one form or another with a view to meeting that data need, but simply they are not doing it on a basis that's comparable with other areas, or is it that they're just not bothering?
Yeah, there are some quite stark comments in this section of the briefing paper, Mr. Beattie. Sheila can come in and say a bit more about just how it operates in different parts of the country, but the overall implications that we are noting here is that there's an inability or unwillingness to share health and social care data where it is collected across different providers, and significant implications arising from that. So, as you mentioned in your question, there is not a comparable data record between social care compared to NHS. So we all have individual NHS records that you know follow us if we move from one area to another or across our lives. That's not the case with social care. Implications of that, I think, as we touched on in the briefing paper, and some of the direct experiences that deter people from moving house, moving local authorities, some of the challenges that they've had in building a care package around them. And then also, as we mentioned in paragraph 23, there's not a consistent method of recording unmet need. So there's a real lack of information there about the demand for services and the experiences that people are therefore having. So whilst assessments will be carried out of kind of people's social care requirements, that then is applied against an eligibility criteria of whether people are met. If they are not therefore met, there's no consistent method of recording what alternatives might be available for people. So some very significant implications ultimately for the quality of social care that people will receive currently, and anticipating what demand will be on social care in the future. All of these issues really need to be tackled. And again, come back to that theme of urgency. This is one of the things that ought to be done now, to look at the need for data to be consistent, usable, transferable, and based around people's needs, as opposed to some of the concerns of the organisations that are involved in the sector. And you'd ask specifically about kind of what's happening in different areas, and I think it may be useful to bring Sheila in at this point.
Thank you. So yeah, maybe start off with that point that there's not an individual record the same way. So being able to take that with you is not in place. We do know that there's different systems happening within different integration authority areas. That's not necessarily a bad thing, because you know organisations have different individual requirements, but what is missing is that ability to take it up a level so that you can pull together what that means for demand, what that means for unmet need, what that means for the demographic pressures going forward, so that there's a more strategic approach to using the data. If that makes sense.
Just one last question, or general. We're quite correctly looking at a national care service, which hopefully will provide a uniform standard of care across all of Scotland. Without this data, how successful can that be?
That's a very clear answer to that, Mr. Beattie. That, and just if I maybe just highlight to the committee, we have paragraph 38 to the briefing paper set out some of the points that need to be in place to ensure that public sector reform, whether it's a national care service or elsewhere, are successfully delivered. And one of the components of that is a clear business case, anticipated outcomes, and transferable, measurable, consistent data is a key component of that.
So the National Care Service really needs, as part of the process of formulating it and getting it in place, it needs good data behind it to ensure that it's going to be effective. Would that be correct?
Absolutely correct, and certainly that's one of the, as I mentioned a moment or two ago about our reflections on Christie, that policy to be implemented successfully, subject to effective scrutiny and evaluation reflecting the experiences of users of any system, that there has to be clear milestones, data points, and consistent high quality data throughout.
Thank you.
Thanks, Colin. Right, I'm now going to turn straight away to Sharon Dowie, who's got a series of questions to put. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Boyle. The briefing states that Scotland's ageing population will inevitably result in an increasing demand for social care services and resources. Paragraph 25 outlines it's predicted that by 2038, nearly 25% of the population will be over the age of 65. So to what extent is the increased funding from the Scottish Government over the current parliamentary term likely to meet the needs of the growing ageing population in Scotland?
I think both those things are true, actually. That, you know, so we set out in this section of the briefing paper about the a quarter of people by 2030, as you say, Deputy Convener, will be over the age of 65. And then also expand that to say about a fifth of the population in Scotland define themselves as having a disability, with disability, of course, being more prevalent in older population. And then some of the projected, anticipated 80% increase in population of wheelchair users by 2024. All of these statistics combine to talk about increasing demand for the service of social care. At the same point, we do know in the briefing paper that there is anticipated funding increases over the life of this Parliament by £800 million, together with whichever spending decisions the Parliament chooses to make with the increase in the national insurance contributions. But in and of itself, and I think it maybe speaks to Anthony's point, and he might wish to elaborate further, is that the sustainability of this sector won't be tackled by funding alone. And as Scotland emerges from the pandemic, the importance is not to rebuild a system that was already unsustainable, but perhaps to use opportunities now for reform of the system that allows it to deliver, you know, better outcomes, experience for people who are relying on social care and are working in the sector. Anthony, may wish to come in.
Certainly, thank you very much. It's quite right that having budget gaps looking forward in terms of the medium to long term, we haven't yet, I think, been able to kind of overlay the predicted expanded funding and whether or not that will actually address their budget gaps. Irrespective of that, as the Auditor General says, what we need to see, and I think we've been saying this for some time, is change and reform. You know, simply delivering what we've been delivering hitherto is not going to be the right way forward. The whole commitment to more community-based provision, more preventative services, were all framed around trying to develop and implement a more sustainable social care system. And we've seen progress in that front, but as the briefing makes clear, and as the Feely report makes clear, that change hasn't been quick enough or widespread enough. So therefore, I think the challenge for the next few years, as you miss, and then the challenge for the National Care Service itself, is making sure that we have sustainable models in local areas. And that requires changes by health boards, changes by councils, and stronger leadership by integration joint boards.
Okay, I think I caught that there. You mentioned as well about the national insurance contributions. So the increase is set to provide an extra £1.1 billion to Scotland. Has any work been undertaken to establish what proportion of the funding will go towards social care?
I'll check with colleagues in the team if we've any sight of that analysis, Deputy Convener, about kind of the spending plans that the government have set out. If memory serves me correct, there may be references in the medium-term financial strategy, but apologies, I don't have that detail to hand, but I'll check with the team if we've got any additional comment. If we don't, we can come back to the committee in writing.
No problem. You'd obviously mentioned there about change and reform as well. So you've kind of covered that. So I was basically going to ask about the required shift of the delivery of social care services to a preventative approach. But has anything been done about the relative cost effectiveness of investing in preventative care as opposed to only paying for support when someone's at crisis point?
There's a significant body of work, Deputy Convener, about the relative cost and also better outcomes from moving to a preventative care model, as opposed to, particularly in a kind of health and social care setting, about the impact of, you know, typically felt at, you know, for unscheduled, unplanned care presentations at A&E, the kind of the duration of stay in hospital, challenges of then creating care packages, impact on delayed discharges, and the knock-on implication throughout the system of health and social care. We mentioned already this morning about, you know, this kind of, this thinking isn't new. You know, certainly, you know, the Christie Commission explored this in detail, you know, 10 plus years ago now, about the both the most cost-efficient, not the key driver necessarily, but the better outcomes that, that people receive from having a preventative approach applied to their social care and health needs. That is well set out. There are some references in our own paper, but again, we're more than happy to come back to the committee with additional comments and sources if that would be helpful.
Just finally, paragraph 28 states that two-thirds of integration authorities were unable to achieve a balanced budget in 2018-19 without additional funding from partners. The briefing also highlights at this paragraph that the introduction of free personal and nursing care resulted in the development of eligibility criteria to manage demand for services. This has led to local variations in response to financial pressures across Scotland. So could you provide some further detail on the local variations that exist with regard to the eligibility criteria for free personal and nursing care and the extent to which you believe there's a postcode lottery for care?
If I may actually just invite Anthony to answer that question, again, given his he's closer than I am to the individual workings of integration joint boards.
This is not a new issue. This was an issue that we commented on in the Social Working Scotland report in 2016, when we saw that the pressures that were faced by local authorities meant that in many cases they were having to revisit their eligibility criteria. So where previously they might have been adopting more of a preventative model, and the threshold for receiving services was set at a particular level, many local authorities were moving to place a threshold on accessing to be really in quite a critical need. And at that point, we were highlighting the fact that this was running very much counter to the topic we've just been discussing, which is a shift towards prevention. It really meant that people were only accessing services when the needs were very significant. We will be able to provide a bit more further information for you, Sharon, on that, on IGOs as well. It's a significant issue.
Right, OK, thank you.
OK, thanks very much indeed. Anthony Clark mentioned about change and reform on the agenda, and Craig Hoy's got a final series of questions about what the future holds. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Boyle. Before we go perhaps into the detail of the proposals for a national care service, don't want to preempt what the government will finally come forward with. But given that your report identifies that there is an urgent need for actions in relation to the present system, particularly in adult social care, is there a risk that the difficult decisions that need to be taken now could be put on hold, especially given the much wider scope and remit for a possible national care service, which goes well beyond that envisaged by the Feely review?
So I think we've got ourselves to the position that there's both these things. So there's a need for some urgency to address the threats to the sustainability of the social care sector that can't wait for a national care service. We've talked this morning about particularly the workforce challenges, recruitment, retention, sickness, absence levels, sharing of data, kind of consideration of the commissioning model. All of these things can be thought about, tackled now before the government takes its time with discussion with the Parliament about what happens and how the National Care Service will be structured. So we think the key message from our report today, Mr. Hoy, is that there's an urgency to address some of the challenges that the sector is facing. That needs to be done alongside some of the thinking that will take place about how the National Care Service will deliver better outcomes.
Do you think, though, that there is a risk, if you look at the COSLA responses and individual council responses to the consultation, that there is a risk that there will be a period of paralysis as we go through such a huge structural reform, particularly in relation to workforce issues, and how should we guard against that?
It's undoubtedly when there is a risk that focus turns to governance and structural matters about how a new system, a very significant plank of public sector reform, will be implemented. There are very many people working in the sector. They'll all want to have their voice heard about how that looks and what that means. And therefore, that really takes us back to our key conclusion from today's briefing, that whilst thinking will no doubt take place to develop a national care service, there is a risk that that pushes out addressing some of the very real challenges that need to be tackled now, you know, many years in advance of we see a national care service and begin to feel its impact.
Obviously, you set out, I think, on page 19, the timeline for social care reform. One of the things that I note with some alarm is that even before we've got the full scope of the services that might be provided by a national care service, we see that already management consultants are coming in to put in place programme management structures and the operating model. Is there a risk that we put the cart before the horse here and that we end up building the bureaucratic system independently of the patient-centred or the resident-centred care system that I think Feely envisaged?
I think it's important that government and its partners consult widely, that the views of service users, representative bodies in the sector are reflected alongside any expertise that government decides that it needs to bring in to create structures. I think it goes back to, I think, my previous answer that whilst setting up significant plans of public sector reform will require investment and expertise, that it doesn't push out the need to address some of the very real challenges that the sector is facing currently. And we have many years of consultation and discussion ahead of us in setting up what the National Care Service looks like. And perhaps reference back to the answer to Mr. Beattie's question, that alongside that, we learn some of the lessons from previous public sector reform and address some of the recurring themes around particularly data, that we are clear on what the outcomes will be. Ultimately, that's, you know, the core ambition from this level of investment, that people who are using and relying upon social care services in Scotland receive a better outcome than they're currently doing so.
Looking at the timetable that you've got on page 19, which effectively has the National Care Service becoming fully operational by 2026, bearing in mind that we're already into the second quarter of 2022 and no legislation has come forward as of yet, do you think that the timetable is reasonable and that any costings that you've seen so far are likely to be deliverable and achievable?
I think there's two things to say. That the scale of public sector reform proposed here is the most significant that any of us will have seen in decades, and that needs to be accompanied by a very clear timeline of deliverables in order to meet the timeline that's suggested. We touched on the briefing that the scope of the National Care Service is significant in terms of adult social care, children's services, social work, drugs and alcohol, and that needs to be accompanied by detailed costings, which have not yet been produced. All of that, you know, needs to be clear for the Parliament to scrutinise, and for users of the service, given, as we've touched on, that there are very many people working in the sector, representative groups, and of course people relying on the service, that their voices are very clear and play a part in shaping what the National Care Service looks like too.
And would you accept that what we're almost talking about here also is a fundamental structural reform of local government? Mr. Clark referred, I think, to needing urgent action from local authorities and IGBs in relation to the present demands and needs of the care service. But obviously we see local government and IGBs effectively being moved out of the picture, or certainly a rebranding of IGBs through this. So as we look at the structures and the ownership of the system, are there going to be risks that we lose accountability at the local level and that we may then end up seeing some of the issues that perhaps you've identified in relation to Police Scotland, for example, in the past?
As our understanding of the consultation, and the same, so like everyone else, we await to see more detail, is that there will be changes in some of the accountability arrangements if they are progressed in the way that the consultation suggests, with the creation of memory says national social care boards. I may have the wrong terminology, but mirroring the role that NHS boards play in an NHS setting. And accountability will move from local authorities to the Scottish Parliament and Scottish ministers. All of that is a process of change, that risk. And I think if you're alluding to, Mr. Hoy, that during that period of change, there is a risk in terms of focus, quality of service and so forth. And I think we're keen to emphasise that that needs to be addressed, that the focus when any significant plank of public sector reform takes place is that, that it's not at the expense of care and the quality of service that, that people receive. And that is a very real, you know, component of that that we come back to, if I may, just in terms of the overall conclusion we make in the briefing paper, that some factors have to be addressed now, not wait for a national care service, and also guard against the risk that as we're going through a period of real structural change, that that also brings an additional threat to the quality of care.
And just finally, in relation to Mr. Beattie, you talked about the importance of data, and also the Scottish Government's consultation envisages a single national IT system for patient and resident records. What would be the risks in putting such a huge scheme together, given that we've seen prior public sector IT systems not always running according to plan or budget?
So I think it's a combination of risks and benefits. The risks clearly that the system doesn't deliver what's intended, doesn't meet the timescales, cost overruns, cybersecurity threats of any system, and that those risks are known and addressed, that guarded against. But also, alongside that, the benefits and opportunities of investing, progressing with IT arrangements are also reflected in the outcomes that come from it. We've not done any work in this yet, I think, but very clearly, I think, as we touched on in the paper and I mentioned this morning, it's our intention to undertake more work on social care in Scotland. And very appropriate parallels, I think, that with a level of reform of this type, we've in Audit Scotland over in recent years look to undertake audit work alongside the implementation of significant changes in policy. So for example, police reform, we produced a number of reports, and also more recently in social security reform, that audit work and assurance that the Parliament will want doesn't wait till a system is implemented, that there's opportunity to audit and comment alongside the development and implementation of policy, and we can anticipate that's where we'll be with the National Care Service.
And just one final question, if I may. Obviously, the Filley Review and the government's consultation continues to envisage the private sector playing a significant role in the delivery and provision of care. How should the government go about making sure it fully engages and keeps the private sector informed and consulted so that it does, in the end, form part of the end solution that we see once there is a national but not a nationalised care service?
You touched on your question. We operate a mixed market in Scotland. That, you know, there's a very clear role for the private sector currently in the provision of social care, and I'm sure that the government will want to engage widely, consult, inform, and listen to the views of providers and recipients of care. Perhaps more a question for the government themselves about the kind of the steps that they're planning to take to ensure that happens.
Thank you very much indeed. Yes, I fear, Mr. Hoy, you're veering to areas of policy and ideology there, which is certainly not the remit of this committee. But anyway, this is a debate which the whole Parliament is going to engage in the next few years. But I think the point that you've been making repeatedly this morning, as well as in the briefing, is that there are some urgent issues that need to be addressed alongside the Parliament's deliberation on the reform of the system. You did also mention your interest that is shared with us about what happened to the £500 million cash injection and how much of that went into social care commissioning. So if you get to the bottom of that, we would appreciate you sharing that with us, because we are anxious to track where the money has gone. We also heard about skills development and some of the innovative things that I think Edinburgh College shared with us in a roundtable discussion that this committee held late last year. Next week we've got the Director General Education and Justice giving evidence on the planning for skills agenda. So we've got clearly quite a lot of shared interests, and what's going on in the care sector is absolutely central to what's happening in the planning for skills work that the Scottish Government is leading on. So can I take the opportunity now to thank Anthony Clark and Sheila Stewart, who have joined us online this morning. To you, Auditor General, as always, thank you for the production of the briefing and for answering our questions on it. and I now want to move the committee into private session.